Comrades, ladies and gentlemen, on the occasion of this autumn conference, Labour in 1915 on the cusp of the revolutionary year, the Irish Labour History Society, the Women's History Association of Ireland, SIP2 Equality and the Young Workers Network, in conjunction with History Ireland, are delighted that the President of Ireland, Michel D. Higgins, was available to give this special speech. So, on behalf of the Labour History Society, a man who has spoken on many occasions at Labour History events over the years, I now call on the President of Ireland, Michel D. Higgins, to address us on the topic of after the lockout, the options for the poor.
Gwini Cor, Erin Gaidal, Chias, Esminla Mawika, Seguala Sakton, Quirit Chiacht, Esve Porchokton, Stadersha, and brothers and sisters of the trade union movement, it's a great pleasure to be here, and I was delighted to accept the invitation. I was invited to speak, as indeed it is, this scholarly weekend is directed at understanding the significance of the year 2015. And also, of course, I was asked to, in the tail of the invitation, to reflect on what the significance of the events of 2015 might have 100 years later. Under some pressure, I have to say, not from events or from the invitation, I have attempted to do just this. I think the first thing to say is that the Ireland of 1915, if we try and project ourselves back, was an Ireland that was midway through a decade of extraordinary change. Extraordinary change in every way, not at home, but on the European continent. It was a change that would see have the consequence of the loss of a generation to war in what I have referred to in other speeches as the collision of imperialist hubris. But here in Ireland, the changes that took place, they placed us on the cusp, as it were, of what is now regarded, described as our revolutionary period. That is contestable, of course, because we've had more than one. This was a decade of turmoil that unfolded in the shadow of the Home Rule Acts, the founding of the Ulster Volunteers, the Irish Volunteers, the establishment of the Citizen Army, the outbreak of the 1914 World War that I've referred to, and it would be followed by the rising of 1916. Putting ourselves in that decade then, it was a decade just on from the last of a series of land acts, legislation that would enable in rural Ireland a property-based culture to emerge and one that could accommodate itself within nationalism. I've often reflected on the membership of the War of Independence around the country, of why you have such an extraordinary overrepresentation of the children who are not inheriting the land, the non-inheriting son, those in the trades and so forth, rather than the land being put at risk, no more than the land could be put at risk decades later in relation to what were regarded as the sexual temptation of the women in the cottages. The content of nationalism, I think, might be characterized by a demand for independence, an independence of decision in economic and social terms. And for some nationalists, this could be accommodated even within the structures of empire. But in 1915, some forms of nationalism, for example, as exemplified by Patrick Pearce, were moving towards Connolly's socialist defense of the working class. Undoubtedly, the influence of this was the lockout of 1913. Indeed, the lockout of 1913 is extraordinary for another reason, and that is that intellectuals at home and in Britain combined, for example, including Shaw. It's a time when Shaw, Singh, Connolly, and so on are in the same room discussing, for example, the lockout. It's useful too to remember that while we have recently commemorated Oda Porter Pierce's oration at the grave of O'Donovan Rossa, that while Pierce could invoke the spirit of the Fenian dead in that oration, those who delivered the shot over the grave were from the citizen army, as indeed the playing of the last post by William Omer was in fact the trumpet, the musician from the citizen army. The citizen army at the point of August 1915 is in fact the dominant force in relation to something very significant that has taken place. Frankly, a number of different cultural expressions and movements have changed onto a conscious militant stance. We can in this decade, I think, too, that decade of 1915 at its center, notice the widening of a divide between city and country. And I think within the class systems of both the urban and rural societies. At the level of the workers in Dublin, it was a decade that had witnessed, as I have said, the most significant event in Irish trade union history, indeed in Irish social history of the early 20th century, the great lockout in Dublin, which had taken place in 1913. The project that was the lockout left its significant and enduring mark, I suggest, on not just the industrial, but the entire social landscape of Ireland. In rural areas, land consolidation was well underway. I think the early decades, what I mean by that is, of course, the dominance of graziers who had emerged as a significant force in the local elections of the 1890s, but also, I think, the land consolidation, I say, in the rural society, albeit supporting a nationalism, it had emerged to constitute a new native predator class. And thus, the early decades of the 20th century in Ireland saw a rural landscape emptied of the possibilities of vegetation through the effects of the famine and immigration, which had disproportionately removed labourers and smallholders from the rural areas. Then in the city of Dublin, there can be little doubt that the lockout had defined the nature of commerce and class relations in the city. Desmond Greaves has stated that one of its effects was on the workers of all industries was to stricken their consciousness of themselves as a class. So if the effects of the Gortha Mór and immigration had radically reduced the numbers of agricultural labourers in rural areas, as I said, where the grazier class could now also enjoy the support of senior church leaders. In the land war of 1879 to 1882 and succeeding in relation to the evictions that were taking place, it was not uncommon, I suggest, to find local curates occasionally defending the rights of what they call the conges. On the other hand, you would have bishops who would occasionally condemn agrarian violence. By the time we get to that decade there of which we're speaking this evening, things have nicely stabilized in a coexistence of this new landholding form and the church. Today, the class divides which existed in the years leading up to the lockout seem quite extraordinary. If I might draw on work, as I have before, of such brilliant and courageous contemporary historians such as Catherine Crowe and Dermot Ferreter, as to the significance of the census of 1911, a census which depicted a Dublin of the most extreme contrast. And on the occasion of giving the Littleton lecture, I drew on their work to suggest what in fact was reported from Dublin on the night of the census of 1911. at the exclusive Kildare Street Club, where six visitors on census night included a landowner, a land agent, a retired colonel, the official starter at Irish race meetings, and Lord Fermoy. 32 staff attended to their comfort. The German waiters from the Shelburne Hotel lived nearby on Kildare Street, while William Butler Yeats and Lady Gregory were staying around the corner in Nolan's Hotel on South Frederick Street. The lockout contributes then, I think, in many cases, when the firm contributes massively to 1915. You can't understand 1915 without taking from what had taken place in terms of 1913 and the response to the events. Equally, part of this project, I understand, to which I have an invitation to speak, is seeing how 1916 is affected by 1915. I think what was very significant, what did I mean when I said one sees an increasing militancy from cultural categories to militant categories? The end of the 19th century is a ferment of activity of an intellectual kind, wonderful intellectual engagement, people denouncing each other, publishing pamphlets, people bringing out essays and so forth. And this is reflected too as well in relation to defenses of the Irish language. Massive marches, public marches, in defense of the right to speak your own language. At some of these, Douglas Hyde speaks. And of course, as part of what I have to say, is one of the symbolic consequences of this shift I mentioned from culture to militancy, is when Douglas Hyde leaves the Gaelic League at a meeting in Dundalk. I think that Dublin is a Dublin marked by poverty and hunger, a city where tens of thousands live in tenement slums, slums that would continue until the 1950s, and of course, which have a great danger of being repeated, starved into ill health, scraping a living on the margins of society. It's a city about which Sir Charles Cameron, the medical inspector of Dublin, will report, "It is certain that infants perish from want of sufficient food." But through the exhaustive work of the historians I've mentioned, we've gained in recent years a far greater knowledge and understanding of the scale and nature of poverty in Dublin at the time. 1/3 of families live in one-bedroom accommodation. These were often very large families, and the death rate generally, and for infants in particular, was among the highest in the world. So economic and social conditions were the context then in which that first labour unrest and later nationalist unrest were to come forth. And while the lockout marked the beginning of a new era where Irish workers would come together in solidarity and the trade union and labour movement would carve out a significant part of the new Irish state, there can be no doubt, let us be clear, that the lockout did not signify any immediate victory for the Irish working class. Reflecting on the circumstances in which the workers found themselves at its end, James Connolly stated, "From the effects of this drawn battle, both sides are still bearing heavy scars. How deep those scars are, none will ever reveal. But the working class has lost none of its aggressiveness, none of its confidence, none of the hope in the ultimate triumph." Nevertheless, many of those driven to return to work had to do so in a spirit of defeat, as O'Casey and others have so well charted for us, and having been forced, if they were allowed to return, to pledge to distance themselves from larkinism in the future. Many more were blacklisted and left unable to find employment. And the routes out of unemployment then that were taken by those now debarred from working in this country varied. Most tragic were the large proportion who felt that they had no choice but to join the British Army in order to secure the separation allowance for their dependents, which after all was fractionally more than the prevailing wage. And thus they became victims of the cruel and murderous conflict that was World War I, or if they survived, would face significant hostility on their return home. If one wants to look about the power of history, it is very interesting about what we have all been through in relation to 2014 and recalling 1914. Few now are the people who refer to World War I as the Great War, and many are the people who are inclined to regard it as the great catastrophe in terms of human terms. So it does matter, the discourse and the titles that are allowed to be used within it. Earlier this year, I participated in the commemoration sermon at Gallipoli, a moving and deeply sad occasion which recalled the 4,000 Irish men who lost their lives in that failed invasion of Turkey during the First World War. There were, of course, varied reasons why so many Irish men decided to sign up during World War I. They vary. However, we must ask ourselves, of those 4,000 Irish citizens who died at Gallipoli, and not only there, but at all the other sites of World War I, how many were motivated to fight in that war by political idealism? Yes, there were many. How many enlisted out of a desire for escape and adventure? Perhaps some. But yet, how many were in Gallipoli on that tragic and fateful day and at all those other sites of war? Because they quite simply had no other means of supporting their wives and children. Those, as I said, who were driven to enlist by seeking for, in search of the separation allowance. And then there were those who returned with chronic injuries. And remember, by 1915, word had come home about the extent of the losses in the war. And this was running through Dublin in terms of rumours. Again, the ones with chronic injuries had often to return and seek to make themselves invisible in communities that had reacted furiously, and later, the following year, in 16, to the savagery of the executions of the leaders of the 1916 Rising. The impact on Irish society of these losses of human life occurring in these years was profound, and Catherine Tynan has put it as follows. Dublin was full of mourning, and in the faces one met, there was a hard brightness of pain, as though the people's hearts burnt in the fire and were not consumed. The midpoint of that decade then, 1915, was a turning point in an Ireland which became increasingly opposed to involvement in the First World War, leading to another great mobilization that would of course take place in April 1918, the one-day strike in opposition to threatened conscription, a one-day strike which brought the national economy to its knees. But by now, the intellectual movements of the previous decades had made an unanswerable case for, while they'd made an unanswerable case for a cultural respect, they were now making way for a more militant prosecution of independence. The traumatic effect of the level of the deaths at Gallipoli had a profound impact on social and political attitudes. The legitimacy of the system of government in the country could not be maintained. In the face, objectively, of what was a stark social inequality, but it was now combined with the needless deaths of so many young men, and indeed the authority of that economic order, characterized as it was by the exploitation I have described, became more difficult to sustain. In such a volatile political environment, the just cause of labour could not be suppressed as completely as some had hoped. Indeed, while William Martin Murphy had won a victory in the short term in 1913, he was not successful in his greater aim of destroying the Irish Transport and General Workers' Union or of bringing an end to organised general trade unionism. Neither could he repeat the lockout of 1913. In 1915, when he attempted to do so, to make a further attempt at lockout, he was not supported by employers who had learned a salutary lesson in 1913 as to the costs in economic, but also in social terms, and thus they refused to join William Martin Murphy in his second attempt. Today, when we take a long view of the year that was 1915, we see it as a time then of grief for the lives that had been lost so senselessly in a futile war, a time of gross social inequality, but a determined searching for democratic rights, a time when society was permeated with a deep sense of unrest, and consequently a time when a rising tide of militant nationalism resulted in the mobilization and expansion of the volunteer movement. Ireland was setting out again, as it were, on its journey towards independence. And while Home Rule was being spoken of by some as being just a few short years away, the egalitarian flames, I must say, within the competing forms of nationalism were sadly faint, but they were there. The idealism of an independence with structural change and emancipatory promise perhaps found its strongest expression in the citizen army. And it was that strain of the independence movement which would, of course, bear the brunt of the actual insurrection when it came. But also, too, it is that section which would suffer the opprobrium of a beaten down or, in so many respects, dependent public trapped within the structure and the thinking of empire. Discussing 1915, then, and the significance of that year with a historian friend of mine recently, he stressed to me how, following a number of measures of repression, the end of 1914 in particular, but then in the spring, the defense of the Relim Act of March 1915, the censorship of publications, which had, as I said, that came earlier in 1914 in November, but it meant that in response to a plethora of increasingly militant speeches and publications, all such manifestations were regarded as acts of sedition. So thus, if you'd had, as it were, those marches, that time when Douglas Hyde is still president of the Gaelic League, that time is very active in the Gaelic League, and before he leaves and so on, you also now have such a heavy-handed act of repression at the end of 1914, and that is repeated in the defense of the Relim Act of March 1915, all such manifestations were regarded as acts of sedition. So that 1915 was a year that saw a regrouping of the forces, but also a change in their character that represents what I describe as a dramatic shift towards militancy. And as that drumbeat of militancy became more pronounced, it affected everything. I've said it is Douglas Hyde resigned from what he regarded as a politicized Gaelic League moving towards militancy. And then again, in 1915, Padraic Pearse's The Siege is produced, and in that work of Pearse's, one sees a movement from a culturally based critique towards militancy. And as you are seeing, a convergence of views moving from the nationalism of Pearse's nationalism towards Connolly. As to intellectual expression of that militancy, the publication in May 1915 of James Connolly's The Workers' Republic was deeply significant in terms of theory and propaganda. Jim Larkin had gone to the United States, and Connolly was in charge and could give a new impetus to the struggle for workers' rights in an independent Ireland. But it is in 1915, too, that Arthur Griffith's Nationality, part of a series, appears. And thus you had, as it were, an intellectual invocation of independence with strikingly different content between these two. Quite simply, may I suggest, then, that one has to take full account of the ferment of publishing and other activity that characterized 1915 in order to understand 1916. There was a widespread sense of crisis, of old systems coming under immense strain, of new ideas of being brought forward, of there being nothing left to lose in many sections. And in all of this debate, one always had in the vanguard extremely strong in female voices. And you also had, in the preparation for the forthcoming militancy, be it in the shops and be it in the information system, women at all levels of competence and skill participating. And thus, I'm really pleased that women's role in this turbulent decade is being given recognition at your conference. You asked me in the invitation to me to make a reflection on what we might learn from all of this, into which we might put it. Well, today, 100 years on, Ireland within the European Union has been experiencing another contemporary serious crisis of legitimacy, reflected, for example, in a great sense of disappointment in trusted institutions which are perceived to have failed the citizenry. We are, I hope, perhaps emerging from a baleful chapter in our history, one that saw the collapse of a version of Irish economy that had been made vulnerable by its being built on property speculation. Individualism as a philosophy and a model of economics that was described as regulation with a light touch, but which had the effect of severing the economy from social reality. The fallacies, the unexamined assumptions underpinning the heart of the dominant modes of thinking of this period, and which now have been exposed, must surely provoke scholars and public alike. But I am moved to say that as I contrast the end of the 19th century, say the 1890s, or the decade of 1915, with the intellectual engagement that has been happening in recent decades, there's quite a difference. It is amazing to me how many people have been able to live uncritically at the heart of a paradigm that is so obviously delivering such consequences, not only in Ireland, but in Europe and the world, for another day. So this chapter to which I refer of our recent past has been one in which the poor suffered more than others, a chapter which saw an ever-growing and deepening crisis of social cohesion, resulting in increases in areas such as homelessness, drug addiction, alcohol abuse, and family breakdown. That chapter of our history, in our history, Ireland and Europe, has deepened a social divide. In the words of Jürgen Habermas, who recognizes the divide as a very European phenomenon, he writes of those who find themselves on the wrong side of that chasm. They do not pay in money values, but in the hard currency of their daily existence. So having also witnessed the large-scale neglect and abandonment of the values of social responsibility by institutions vested with authority and by professions which had jealously guarded their self-regulation, there is now a groundswell of popular demand for a fundamental re-examination of the assumptions and values that underpin the dominant economic and political discourse of our times. I'm always amused when I look back at the historical accounts in Ireland about the struggle over what is regarded as inevitable. We've paid a high price for the certainties imposed upon us. And I think in many cases, what is very interesting is the dissident mind and intelligence within the Irish tradition of writing as to what it feels free to challenge. But there is no doubt at all in my mind is that what is necessary very much is that we have an engaged critical scholarship that will enable our people to be reflexive. I think, in a way, what did I mean when I said about contrasting that decade of insufficient critical examination of the present time with, say, the one of which 1915 is at its center? It is that people had less inhibition about putting their ideas on paper, less inhibition about becoming involved in public conversations, less inhibitions about denunciation and recovery and recoil and reinvention of themselves. That is why it is always such a great nonsense to have said that Ireland was continually modernizing in some linear way. But you know, I think if I was to ask Putin it, that reference I made to land at the end of the 19th century, and as you move into 1900 to 1930, you add to the land the demand for respectability. I think of Beckett's line where Winnie says, "Keep yourself nice, Winnie." Well, people did keep themselves nice and quiet, and they paid the price. So as in 1915, an effective and meaningful response to this crisis requires coherent and rigorous scholarly analysis, but also communication of that analysis. Otherwise, it evaporates in a populist anger that becomes gestural. And there can be no doubt that Ireland now stands at a critical turning point in its social history. And in this regard, the process of reflection and commemoration is directly relevant to the task of our addressing our future. What do we want to commemorate, and what distinctions do we make between remembering, commemorating, and celebrating? And how much respect will we give to the complexity of that to which we address our scholarship? The desire to examine the root causes of what has happened and to reconnect what has been sundered in our society and in our public discourse is helped by bringing an ethical respect, as I suggest, for complexity to our historical reflections. Yes, by deconstructing the turbulent events of 100 years ago in all their facets, we can perhaps gain an understanding of the dangers that can stem from social and political crises, particularly when not analyzed. But we can also perceive more clearly the potential for radical renewal when fresh ideas and an emancipatory vision are put before the people as inspiration. With a fresh eye, the necessary radical rethinking of accepted orthodoxies and their replacement with alternatives enable us to move to discussing our possibilities, our fedrakte, in a shared space of solidarity and celebration of our common humanity. The circumstances of recent times, the challenge of future change, issues an invitation to discourse and debate. For example, among the challenges we face at this moment is the debate on the definition of work itself. With the mantra of labor market flexibility as some kind of flag of convenience being abused by some powerful interests at home and abroad to justify some current conceptions of labor as being a mere commodity, and the worker as simply being a unit of that commodity, it becomes necessary to pose the alternative of decent work. The demand for the recognition of the worker as a human being entitled to dignity, security, for recognition of their role as citizens in a deliberative democracy, as Habermas would put it, one that enables participation. Any consideration of the ethical and social dimensions of work and the workplace must challenge any reductive view of the worker as simply a commodity. And we must insist that in the discourse that is now unfolding, that all workers are seen as rounded citizens with rights, requiring family and community relations, and with the right to participate in society. As Amartya Sen put it, to participate without shame in your society is the definition of equality. Entitled to a balanced life, in which their employment, yes, plays its rightful role, but does not supersede the many other elements necessary to a full and productive life. Such an understanding of work suggests a view of society within a republic where economic arrangements are made accountable to, and above all instrumental to, social policies that receive the assent of citizens who have participated themselves in the drafting of the options that produce such policies. The 1913 lockout took place in a Dublin which lacked a proper industrial base, where many starved in tenement slums, and where our fight for independence was discussed and still to be won. Many pages of our history have now intervened, and we are, in all our failures, achievements, and new fragilities, a very different country from that which emerged from the lockout era 1915, 100 years ago. However, we must recall and learn from the fact that the lockout and the discussion of 1915 took place against a background of casual work with little security and wages which were difficult to live on with pride or dignity. Sadly, the concept of the vulnerable and insecure worker has not been obliterated from our society over the decades. Today, many of our citizens are trapped in chronic job insecurity. Indeed, job insecurity is often dismissed as an outdated notion, a thing of the past. That's all gone now. A concept that does not fit with a dynamic, globally connected, innovative labor market. Temporary or short-term contracts, internships, and the discretion of employers to vary employees' working hours with minimal notice have led to an increasing percentage of our population working in precarious, low-paid and poor-quality jobs with little possibility of personal development or career progression. In the European Union, and Ireland as part of it, concerned social economists are writing now of the emergence of a new precariat. Many workers are not only denied the benefit of organised labour, a battle which was at the heart of the 13 lockout and which continued through 15. They are also refused the right to decent work, employment that would provide a source of personal dignity and freedom, which would be capable of providing security for a family, serve the basis for security in the community, and for democratic flourishing and participation. Isn't it interesting that the rationalizing paradigm of empire, could be confronted 100 years ago, and now we are asked to have the courage to confront the dominating economic paradigm of our time with all its regional, continental, and global consequences. I believe that now more than ever, we need to empower all our citizens with an appreciation of history in all its complexity, of rights and how they were won, of an economic literacy that will enable them to participate in decisions, to have knowledge of how we got to where we are, an understanding of the conflicts that occurred along the way and why, or perhaps the many reasons as suggestions as to why, as well as the consensus that emerged for a while, of the need to link national and international issues that are aspects of our common humanity's aspirations. It is history that has shaped our society and which will be the basis for the future we might craft together. And it is vital that today's generation have a deep and textured understanding, not only of the 1913 lockout and its causes and effects, but also of it and the events of 1915, these changes that took place that in turn led to 1916, and how those events challenge us to have an appreciation of our duty and responsibility, to build on all that was achieved by those who fought and made profound sacrifices in the past to ensure a fairer and more just society today and tomorrow. And we must seek to recover too, as I'm sure your conference will attempt, that atmosphere where some were allowed to bring back, some allowed to return to work at the cost of their rights, others forced to fight abroad so that those at home might eat, and how some were coming to the conclusion that faced with these contradictions, independence was a necessary precursor to the achievement of workers' rights. That was 1950, and all of this vortex would feed into the cauldron that would source the actions of 1916. Toshichaka. But today, in contrast with 1915, we address the challenges of our time in the context of an independent and free nation and as a prosperous and equal society, where we have the power and the opportunity and the ability to control our own destiny and to grasp the great issues of our time and of this generation. Great issues that are global issues, such as global hunger, inequality, climate change, gender exclusion and violence, which we should not have to wait to end. And over the coming year, we will all reflect on the idealism of the words and vision and the legacy and meaning of 1916, and particularly of the words of the proclamation. So what better time to seek again the opportunity to build and define our society, and to do so by the creation of an ethical foundation of which our republic can emerge, grow and thrive, and which our citizens can fulfill their potential in peace and security, in health and in happiness. Barbanacht Gramacht.